Hello Pixel Pioneers, welcome back to another exciting tutorial. Today, we're venturing into the mesmerizing world of parallax effect, a technique that breathes life into any static image, turning them into dynamic 3D scenes. Whether your image is crafted in a 3D software like Maya or Blender, generated through AI tools like Stable Diffusion, Midjourney or DALL-E, or captured through a lens in a moment of inspiration, the magic of parallax can transform it into any visual adventure. Before we jump into DaVinci Resolve, let's ensure you have an image at hand that you want to turn into a captivating parallax effect. I have an image here that I have created during just another Stable Diffusion session. If you have one too, that's great. With that image, we need to prepare a crucial element called depth pass. A depth pass is a grayscale image where the whiteness indicates the distance from the camera, setting the stage for the parallax magic we are about to create. Head over to Stable Diffusion. If you don't have Stable Diffusion installed, just have a look at one of my former tutorials where I guided you through the overall installation of Stable Diffusion. You can find the link at the right upper side. Today, we don't want to prompt any images by the text to image tab. We want to focus on the depth creation. Therefore, head over to the depth tab. If you don't see it, you don't have it installed. Just head over to the extensions, check under installed if you have Stable Diffusion Web UI Depth Map script available. If you don't, just click at the link that I will provide in the description. Go to install from URL, paste this link in, hit install. After that, you will have to restart Stable Diffusion and then you will have the depth tab available. We can be a bit more fancy in one of our next tutorials for the depth part with all those different settings. Today, we're trying to keep it simple. All we want to do is we want to create a depth pass from an existing image. Therefore, take the image you want and drag and drop it simply into the single image source. Let's stay high level on the most important settings. So you can compute on a GPU or on a CPU. If you have enough VRAM available, choose GPU, otherwise go with the CPU. Make sure that boost stays on, you have save outputs and output depth map. Yes, you want to have the depth map because that's the reason for us to stay within Stable Diffusion. Save outputs, it's really up to you, you can turn it on or off. If you turn it on or leave it on, it just means that every time you hit the generate button, the image is also being stored at the local folder of Stable Diffusion. If you want to save a bit space, turn it off because you don't need it. You can save your image via the web UI here. Let's head over to the model section. So there's a drop-down menu and here you find all pre-installed depth pass methods. All of them have a different way of calculating the depth pass. Therefore, all of them will provide you different results. We're not rendering all those different things out, but I would like to present them to you. So here you find all different depth passes that can be rendered out from the depth extension. And you already see they all have kind of a dramatic difference between each other. So therefore, I think the ones that works best is Res 101 as well as Midas 2.1. Here you're on a fresh start of DaVinci Resolve. Just make sure that you're within the edit page. The first thing you have to do is you have to implement the image as well as the depth pass that we have just generated earlier. Let's start with the image, drag and drop, followed by the depth pass. First thing we have to do is we have to create the fusion composition. Head over to the effects site, search for fusion, drag and drop it down, make sure it starts at frame zero. Let's select the fusion composition. Select it, you see it's being highlighted with a red edge around it, and head over to the fusion page. Currently, the fusion composition is rather empty. All you have in here is the media output. But what do you want to do with in media output if you have no input? Therefore, let's start to drag our RGB image down. For easiness, we just rename it RGB input. Let's do the same with the depth. Great. Whenever you want to see the direct impact of your nodes, at the moment we only have the RGB input and the depth input node, but we will create more nodes later on. But whenever you want to see what they actually do, you can just click on one of these nodes and drag them into the media out canvas. And immediately you will see the result of your nodes. Depth, RGB, media out. Guess what? It's empty because media out is not yet connected to anything. Since we want to create our parallax effect in the 3D space, the next thing we have to do is we have to create an image plane that we can project the RGB input onto. So therefore, head over to the effects page and search for image. And here you find the image plane 3D. Drag and drop it down. Connect the RGB input to the image plane. And as said before, you can take any of these nodes and drag them into the media out to see the direct impact of the node. So here we are with the image plane, and you see that the plane is now being projected with our RGB input, and we're in the 3D space. The next thing we need is actually the displace 3D node. Go back to your effects and search for displace. You have to take the displace 3D node. Why? Because we're in a 3D space. So just drag it down and connect the image plane with the displacement node. Next we need is a depth blur. Go back to the effects and search for depth. Here's the depth blur. Drag it down and connect your depth input with the depth blur. Let me quickly highlight what the depth blur is actually doing. I put the depth input on the left side and the depth blur on the right side so that I have a good comparison between both. Make sure to have depth blur selected, that you have the depth blur settings available on the right side. On the filter, quickly change to super soften, the blur channel, go with Luma. You might not see a lot of a difference between left and right, but have a look at the right side. If I'm now increasing the blur size overall, my depth pass is getting blurred in comparison to the original input. And that is the reason for me to have a depth blur in place so I can alter the original input. Let me change it back to that. Let's get a bit three-dimensional. Let's drag the displacement node into the canvas, but nothing is happening. It's simple, because you only have connected the RGB input into the image plane, and the image plane in the 3D world can be considered your polygon object, and you want to displace something onto this polygon object, and therefore you have the displacement node. But there's nothing that the displacement node can take right now to calculate the distance and the dimension. Therefore, you have to start now connecting your depth input into the displacement node, and let's just do that. Now you have an image plane that appears to be 3D. It's not flat anymore. But what the hell is it? You can't do anything with it, right? That is because your image plane is considered to be the 3D object. And if you click onto the image plane, you see that right now we're at a subdivision step 10. And if you just click on the wireframe, you actually see what it means. So those kind of polygons here are very low poly, not detailed enough. Therefore, it looks very ugly. Now, guess what is happening if I'm now increasing my subdivision to 2000? Have a look. You see what is happening now? Now I have enough information in my image plane with having increased the subdivisions to 2000. And now suddenly the depth input, together with the displacement node, has enough information to project us onto the image plane. And now, from here and from here, it looks very ugly, but you want to have it somewhat from here. And look what is happening. It appears now to be three-dimensional. Now we need the camera. Head back to the effects and search for camera. And you take the camera 3D and drag it down. You have now created a camera in the 3D space, but this camera alone doesn't do anything. You have to ensure that the camera is now being merged together with the displacement node, and therefore we have to merge them. Easiest way to do that is go back to the effect and look for merge. And again, since we are acting in the 3D space, we need to have a merge 3D. In order to bring this all together and connect it to the media out, you need to have just one more node in, and that is the render node. Since you are in the 3D space, you need to have a render 3D node that brings all those 3D informations together, packs them into information that the media out can recognize. You connect the merge and the render 3D to the media out, and on the media out, you change it to hardware renderer. We have all nodes available to create a great parallax effect. Now that we have everything connected to the media out, we could just drag the media out to the canvas. And we might wondering why it is empty, right? Let's have a look at the 3D space. That is because your camera is positioned behind the 3D object. You want to ensure that your camera is moving in front of that object. Head over to the camera. Go to the transform and push the translation of the Z-axis to be in front of the overall character. push it as far as the overall distortion doesn't be that apparent anymore. I have a solid standing with 7. You want to have the three-dimensional effect coming only from your projected polygon plane and not from the effect of your camera, such as the focal length or the angle of view. Let's head over to your camera, go to the controls, and change the projection type to orthographic. Navigate to the scale parameter and increase it until the image fills the entire canvas. And then continue to increase the scale even further to ensure there are extra pixels around the edges. This extra space will be useful later on when animating the camera to prevent reaching the image's edge. Now let's start to animate our camera that we also see something from our parallax effect. So head over to the camera, go to transform, and let us focus on X and Y in a rotation axis. X is for up and down, and Y is for left and right. We're going with the entire length of the fusion composition that we have created at the beginning. The entire length is 0 till 119 frames. Let's start with 0 and key X and Y. Go to the last frame, key X and Y with 0 rotation, because we want to have a loopable animation. That means the first frame and the last frame should always be the same. Perfect. Now that we have that, let's jump over to frame 30 and focus on a shift to the right side. We're going here with -0.5. Now let's head over to frame 90 and change this to +0.5. And now we have a shift from left to right and back. Fantastic. Now let's have a focus on X. So we're going to 60 and change X to 0.3 so that we have a small shift upwards. Now we have left and right as well as up and down. The entire animation feels at the moment very linear. That's because there is no smooth interpolation between the different keys that we have created earlier. We can solve that. Let's go back to frame 0, click on the camera, head up to the spline section. And here you have the X rotation and the Y rotation. We're focusing first on the X rotation. You might not see anything, or it might appear flat. You just have to change that here and increase it a bit so that you literally zoom in and see more of the real happening in there. You select the three different keys, 0, 119, and 60, and you smooth it out by selecting that icon here. And now you have a perfect interpolation of your entire flow. We do the same now with the Y rotation. Similar principle, you have the different keys. We have to zoom in a bit, and now we can start. So all we want to do is we want to change that one here to smooth, and we want to change that one to smooth interpolation. We can keep that and that one as well, because we don't want to have a slow down. We want to have from the end of the frame back to the first one with the same speed. And that's exactly what we have done right now. Now you have a smooth and loopable animation. The next thing, we can have a look at the overall animation together with the parallax effect. Important to understand, this is just the very first result. I will show you afterwards a couple of settings that you can have a look at in order to alter the overall appearance of the image. Close the spline section, head over to the depth blur, and change the blur size to 0, because we don't want to have impact coming from the depth blur overall. Instead, we want to have the original depth input as our base. Have a look at the result. The character and the background is moving in different speed. That's related to the distance to the camera. The character is closer to the camera, and therefore it's moving less. At the same time, with the blur size of 0, the overall character is not changing their perspective. It's moving, but appears to be static, and the background behind is moving. But if you want to alter the result and somehow ensure that also the character is slightly changing the perspective, that the character itself feels a bit more lively, you have to change the blur size, change it to 10, for example, and have a look what is now happening at the character itself. When the camera is moving from left to right, it now suddenly feels like that I'm seeing more of the right shoulder. And the same happens to the head. If I'm moving, I'm suddenly seeing more or less of the left side of the helmet. And that is because I changed the distance to the camera and I changed my blur size so that I have a bit more ongoing in the character itself. So really it depends what you want to do. You whether have the character changing perspective so that the overall image feels a bit more ongoing, or you change the blur size down to zero and you have the character static and only the background somehow changing perspective. Let's have a look at another setting. This time we're focusing on the camera, translation, and Z. At the beginning, we have changed this because we noticed that our camera was actually behind the object, and that was the reason why we moved it in front of it. And that's the same principle we're trying to follow right now. Let's turn this on again and have a look at the overall movement. Now, I am pushing my camera closer and closer to the object. The movement is becoming less and less apparent. I can go even a bit closer. The background is moving. The character appears to be static. Yet, I haven't changed anything on my rotational values. So, use this as a benefit. That means whenever you want to change the speed of your overall movement, don't start to go in all the keys and change the values. Instead, just have a look at the distance from the camera to your object and change it to have the overall movement appearing more or less. And we can now also go to the depth blur and changing the depth blur to 10. So to have again a bit of a perspective change in the overall character, and still it looks stunning. We have covered a lot of ground today. You know now how to create a parallax effect out of a 2D image. No matter if that is being created in a 3D software or with Stable Diffusion, whether it is just a photograph, you can take whatever you have and use the same principle to create a great looking parallax effect. And again, you don't need to start each and every time from zero. If you have done everything right and you followed my principle, you can now simply start to drag and drop every other image into that setting. To prove my point, we can now just drag another image in here. The image and the corresponding depth pass. Now take the image and drag and drop it over the RGB input, hit replace, do the same with the depth pass, change the blur to zero, and if you have done everything right, you have a gorgeous parallax effect on the newly created image. You see the pile of concrete here? Look how it moves in front of the smoke. And there you have it, Pixel Pioneers. We have journeyed through the process of transforming a static 2D image into a lively 2D scene with a captivating parallax effect. From preparing the essential depth pass using Stable Diffusion to crafting the magic in DaVinci Resolve, each step has brought us closer to the dynamic visual storytelling that parallax effects have to offer. I hope this tutorial has ignited a spark of creativity in you and equipped you with the right knowledge to explore the realm of parallax effects in your very own projects. The technique we have explored today opens up a world of possibilities for enhancing your visual content, whether it's for personal projects or professional endeavors. I'd love to see the parallax magic you create, so feel free to share your creation and experiences in the comments below. Remember, the world of visual storytelling is vast and is full of potential, waiting for you to explore and make your mark. Thank you for joining me in today's tutorial. If you found this tutorial helpful, don't forget to hit the like button, share it with fellow creators, and subscribe for more exciting tutorials in the future. Until next time, keep pioneering pixels and pushing the boundaries of creativity. See you in the next tutorial.